Afternoon, South Africa. Welcome to Afternoon Express. Happy Friday! So today on the show we have the legendary singer and songwriter Steve Kekana, who has been a consistent force in the South African music scene since the early 80s. With over 40 albums to his credit, he has also just released his new album called African Lady.
Oh, that's you. Plus we meet actors Duncan Johnson and Seputla Sebogodi, who star in SABC 3's all-new local drama called The Docket that premiered this past Wednesday.
Remember, you can also hit us up on social media and tell us which song is your favorite from our national treasure, Steve Kekana. You can tweet us at Afternoon Chat using the official hashtag Afternoon Express, or you can comment on our Facebook page.
Steve Kekana's music has been featured in numerous movies, and he's collaborated with several artists by the likes of Ray Peary and Nana Koyeta over the years. His duet with PJ Powers on the song Feel So Strong helped him cross over to new audiences, making him one of the most loved musicians in South Africa.
Exactly. He also received this year's Lifetime Achievers Award at the SAMAs. And adding onto his long-standing career, Steve Kekana is also an advocate and a lecturer in labor law at the University of South Africa. Definitely not someone you should mess with.
Absolutely. My mind is made up to start again where I was before. Nothing's gonna stop me now. I've decided to let it show. It's no use pretending I love you.
Ah, and of course we have a legend amongst us. Welcome to The Loft. Fantastic to have you here with us.
Thank you very much. I'm happy that I'm here too with you.
Wonderful. So I believe that you know, you discovered your talent for singing when you were very, very young, but it wasn't your first love. You wanted to be a soccer player. That was your dream. But then somebody heard you singing and that was it for you. What happened there? Tell us that story and how you were discovered.
Well, if I may quote or steal from my friend's way of saying things, yes. Oliver Mtukudzi, I think the first time I came to earth, I sang. But people did not understand the kind of melody I was singing. And they thought I was crying. So that is why this singing went to go and grasp me everywhere I went. At school, my friends were playing soccer and I was a little bit worried, why am I being kept in the school choir? Because I don't want to be singing there while my friends are not there. So I started singing out of tune purposefully. And the teacher chased me away out of the choir, said I'm a bad singer, only to find now I'm getting myself a chance of playing soccer. The mistake I made was that we had a boys' choir which we called Comrades. And I was the leader, I was the one who was writing songs for them and training them, teaching them how to sing, you know, all the four, soprano, alto, tenor, and bass. Blind as I was, I did not see or notice, because there was no way that I was gonna see anyway. I did not notice that the teacher was around, and he saw me and then he admonished me, he said, oh, tomorrow I want you in the choir, or else. And I knew and understood the meaning of or else. Yeah. So that's how I came back into singing while I tried to run away from it.
Yeah.
And then I started liking people like Babsi Mlangeni, Ray Charles, Stevie Wonder, and told myself, if Babsi can do it, I must also go, and not to compete with Babsi. I never had an idea of competing with Babsi, but I had an intention of fulfilling or even adding to what he has done as a blind musician.
Musician, yeah. Well, congratulations on your Lifetime Achievement Award. Obviously, music has treated you really well your whole life.
Yeah, no, music, that's why I keep on telling people. People ask me, what are you? are you an advocate or are you a musician? And I simply say, I'm a musician. I'm definitely am a musician. My friend from Belgium told me when I was admitted in the advocacy, I called him. I said, listen, I have become an advocate. He said, congratulations, my friend, but let me tell you, to me, you remain a musician. And I think he said a mouthful.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
So outside of music, I can only imagine going blind from the age of 5. Schooling for you was very different. What type of lessons or life lessons that you still hold today did you learn back then?
I can simply tell you that I have learned from being blind that there are no shortcuts in life. When you do things, you must do things with all your devotion, intention, and passion. Then you will succeed. Self-pity takes nobody anywhere, and you will forever be behind if you don't want to try and work yourself up. What I want to tell people is that it is better to be always prepared for an opportunity, even though that opportunity might not even come, than to be afforded an opportunity which will find you unprepared.
Exactly.
Yeah. Then you are in trouble.
What a great message.
It's beautiful.
And that's crazy because we're literally just talking about that this whole week, how when you're waiting for your blessing, you need to wait prepared. Yeah. So it's as if God was whispering in your ear with that. Thank you. For reaffirming what we've been saying.
Yeah, we actually said it on the couch just yesterday.
Well, then it means it was a... What can I say? What is the best way to say it?
Prophecy.
Somewhere between me and you, there was a telepathy.
Yes.
And serendipity, yeah.
We're going to be chatting to you again after the break, so you're going to stay right where you are. And, of course, stay at home or stay right where you are at home because after the break, we're going to be continuing the chat with legendary musician Steve Kekana.
And don't forget to tell us which song is your favorite from our national treasure, Steve Kekana. Tweet us at Afternoon Chat using our official hashtag Afternoon Express. We also have a Facebook page. Pop over there and leave us a comment. We'll be right back. Express
yourself. Get ready. The face of cybercrime is changing. And so are we. We are smarter. We take charge. We are in control. We are brave, innovative, everywhere. We are Sabric.
Welcome back from the ad break. You're tuned into Afternoon Express on SABC3, where the stage is yours. Amongst his songs, Steve Kekana has produced one of his most memorable songs called Feel So Strong, a wonderful collaboration with PJ Powers. PJ Powers, she must have been amazing to work with. But something that I read that I thought was so funny was that during the apartheid time, the two of you were like, we don't care about apartheid, we're not for this. And so you used to perform together, and then she used to walk everywhere holding your hand, causing controversy, but actually it was because you were blind. But I loved that story. It was really beautiful. Yeah. Everyone thought that you guys were a spicy item.
Sometimes what happened in the past can be viewed as teaching jokes.
Yeah.
Because seriously, imagine if the police would want to come and run us over because I'm holding a white lady's hand.
Yeah.
Right in the middle of the zoo.
Wow. So you're not only a musician, you're also an academic. You are an advocate now. When did you start studying law?
Well, from 1972, when I was in my secondary, I always wanted to be a lawyer because we went to school with another big brother of mine, Advocate Joe Malachi, who is now a human rights commissioner. So I wanted to follow him. You know, as blind people, we do want to emulate each other who went in front of us. Check, I wanted to be a musician because Bobsy and Ray Charles was a musician. I wanted to be a lawyer because Advocate Joe Malachi and Judge Zach Yakub were lawyers. So, and they are all blind. So it's a matter of following through emulation. But then, 1992, I registered with UNISA. I studied, surprisingly, political science. And I realized that, no, I'm wasting time here. I'm not going to get what I want if I am doing music full-time and studying on part-time. Mm-hmm. I would rather go register full-time and do music part-time. Because this is what I always told myself, that I want to be a part-time musician but a full-time lawyer. So 1994, I registered with a TERF loop. And I got my first junior degree, B. Juris, in 1996. I continued with LLB. I got my LLB in 1998. And then 1999, I became an article clerk. I did not practice. I joined the civil servant in end of 1999 until 2007, when I resigned. I again went back to varsity in 2007 to study LLM, labor law, master's in labor law. So, and then in 2004, I became an advocate.
Wow.
Last year, I went and served my pupillage. People will say, when are you practicing? I think I'll practice next year.
Well, you studied for a very long time.
Wow. Yeah.
And so,
your timelines are very interesting, because making music in the 70s and 80s was a very controversial time to be creating. What are some of the challenges but breakthroughs that you were able to overcome making music at that time?
Well, making music can be difficult in this sense. It's a talent from God. Yeah. It comes to you at night, it wakes you up, you have to sit down, play, strum your guitar or strum mm-hmm. your piano, yeah. only to find that in the morning you're gonna have to go and record it somewhere where some people are owning the recording company and they are giving you very little of your fruit, the fruits of your toil.
Wow.
That is the only difficult thing with making music, is you make money for others and not yourself.
Yeah.
You see, even if you negotiate how hard, they know very well that there was no place where you could go and do some music. Fortunately, nowadays technology has come in handy. People can just record music from their bedroom and sell them through iTunes or whatever.
Yeah.
It's better than that. But in our time, the biggest hurdle is that we made money for others and not for ourselves. I mean, can you believe that when I started recording, I was being given 2.5% of the sales of the record?
That is robbery. That's terrible.
It's not even daylight robbery. It's lifetime robbery.
Yes.
Totally.
Yes.
But now, if you go back on all of those recordings, do you now get royalties much better or from a fairer percentage than just 2.5%?
Well, yeah, now I get a fairer percentage because I...
You're a labor lawyer and an advocate.
After going back to university and studying law, now I know what I need to talk or to say. More especially on intellectual property rights. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, we were told that when we record the songs that we have composed, the publishing company must get 50% of your composer. We went through hard things. Eh?
Totally, yeah. And that's over 40 albums, so that's a lot of intellectual property there.
Yeah. A lot of intellectual property, and now at least from 40, the intellectual property was not mine per se, but now from 41 to 45, at least the intellectual property becomes mine now, because now I knew what I had to do.
Sure.
Like, I mean, I'll be releasing my 45th album.
Wow,
I think on the 16th of September, that is my original
best. That's actually what I want to hear more about when you get to perform a little later on in the show.
Yeah.
But after the break, we're taking it back to the days when fennel cakes were still a thing with Chef Aya as we make a funnel cake in the kitchen. Can't wait.
There's a new face on Espresso, your number one feel-good breakfast show.
I am Thabiso Makubela, and join me with South Africa's favorite morning television family.
Wake up, shake up, and feel good with us for 3 hours of the best breakfast entertainment.
Start your day the only way with us at Espresso Morning Show, weekdays from 6 to 9 a.m. on SABC 3.
The stage is yours.
And yours.
good old-fashioned values and flavors you'll love. Celebrate the taste of yesteryear with Frankie's.
Welcome back from the ad break, Afternoon Express family. The 1950s were known for the typical retro diners, where you would get your hamburgers and milkshakes delivered on roller skates, and you could go watch a movie at the drive-in. Clover Frankie's bring back those nostalgic memories and the taste of yesteryear with the range of drinks. And in celebration of this taste of yesteryear, we are taking it back to the days when fennel cake was still a thing. For this recipe, SMS the keyword Clover to 33650. SMSs are 1 rand 50 each and no free SMSs apply. Aya, it's Friday.
Yes, ma'am.
So Friday means sweet things and nice treats, right?
Yeah, so we're going to be doing a fennel cake, which is like mostly popular in America for like your carnivores and everything.
Yeah.
So with this recipe, I already have the dry ingredients, which is the flour, the sugar, the baking powder, and then...
Okay. A dash of salt, Salt Bay.
So can you mix that for me while now I'm going to be busy getting all the wet ingredients together. So I've got my milk, I'm going to be mixing with my egg, my Frankie's. So the Frankie's comes in different flavors, and the one that I like the most is the ginger one, because I mean, it takes me back to my grandmother's ginger growing up. You know the ginger beer, and it leaves you with that nice burning throat.
That sensation at the back of your throat. I was actually going to say, that's the nice thing about these Clover Frankie's ginger beer, because it's made from the actual ginger root. So it gives you that authentic taste and that burn, that sensation that you like when you have to clear your throat after every sip.
So you mix all the wet ingredients together, your egg, your vanilla essence, and your Clover Frankie's.
Have you already put in the Clover Frankie's?
I did.
Okay,
I did.
Perfect.
So I'm going to pour all of that in there. So the idea is to put this in a piping bag, or if you don't have a piping bag, life hack, we've got a zip bag here.
A Ziploc.
So this is how it is at the end of the day. It must be so runny, but not too runny at the same time, not too thick.
So you cut open that little packet
and
at the bottom.
And then you pipe it so slow in your oil. Like your oil must be on medium heat. So this is what you do.
Nice. So you said the heat must be only on medium heat, not piping hot.
It's more like making your donut, your French coup. I mean, your, what do you call this?
Exactly. This kind of looks like iguinya to me.
Yeah, yeah. But this one, I think, went to varsity. But it's kind of great, like the things you can make with food.
Nice.
And then you must always make sure you've got... A damp cloth or dry paper on the side for you, so that when you put your Frankie's made funnel, you put it over there, and all that oil is going to get dried out.
So when do we know that it's done?
So the color you're looking for, you're looking for that nice golden brown color to it, like the same as like your cook sisters or So that's what you're looking for. Or if you're not sure, you can poke it with a stick to see if that you
get the same trick from yesterday. I'm paying attention when you speak. Okay.
So that is the final product over there. Look at how beautiful that is.
It looks so carnival-y. That's exactly what it actually takes me back to. Exactly what you said, that old school American diner vibe. Beautiful.
So this you can serve with ice cream, or you can have it by itself with coffee or hot chocolate, and also you can have it with just dust of coconut powder.
Nice.
Or you can have cocoa powder, or you can have icing sugar over it. So it's so simple and amazing.
I go for option C, all the above. Now SMS the keyword Clover to 33650 for this recipe, Friday's recipe of this divine Clover Frankie's. And in case you missed any of the any of the details, don't forget you can just SMS Clover to 33657. Here's a recap.
With love by Clover.
So after the break, we meet Duncan Johnson and Seputla Sebogodi, who are the cast members of the new crime-fighting drama on SABC3 called The Docket.
good old-fashioned values and flavors you'll love. Celebrate the taste of yesteryear with Frankie's.
Thank you so much for joining us back on Afternoon Express live on SABC3, where the stage is yours. Now, I recently had the opportunity to attend a fantastic dinner event hosted by McDonald's in celebration of Women's Month, which they called a small moment of great appreciation for the women of South Africa. And I was surrounded by phenomenal women and had definitely had the opportunity to feel appreciated and inspired. Check it out. So tonight I'm at the prestigious One and Only Hotel to join McDonald's South Africa in celebrating South Africa's mothers, daughters, wives, and leaders of industry, and honoring them as phenomenal women. Tonight can be summed up as a small moment of great appreciation.
Leaders from the financial, public, and private sector made up a potent group of speakers, formidable guest list, and McDonald's CEO Greg Solomon was the proud host on the night.
Greg, what a splendid evening. It's such an honor to be here.
As CEO of McDonald's South Africa, why is it important for McDonald's to be in conversation with women?
We're 16 days into Women's Month, And we just don't want this to end. We want this to be a conversation that continues. In McDonald's 20 years ago, we started with a business where we had 25% of all positions, you know, being women. And today we proudly stand here in front of sort of our people and I guess the South African environment. 60% of all people that work at McDonald's are women. Out of my 5 executive teams, 2 are women. So we've really, really focused on being transformed in various different ways. But it's not something we've done. It's something that the women have done.
I've had the honor of meeting some of the incredible women who work for McDonald's. But what role have women played?
I don't even know if I want to use women anymore. I just think it's leaders. They're incredible leaders. They're incredible ambassadors for our organization. And when we talk about diversity in the business, sometimes we categorize it on a gender, and sometimes maybe it's a leadership trait. But for me, it's making sure that different minds, different thought processes, different aspects of life come together. Culture, I guess, is about different people coming together and uniting against a common cause. And women have a part to play. Women hold this business, you know, where it is.
Wow, there is nothing like the fresh, fragrant, beautiful smell of a fragrance to welcome you to such a heartwarming event. It smells absolutely beautiful and certainly sensual.
Baby.
The keynote address was by Namhla Mniki, a global leader and campaigner in development in eradicating poverty and holding governments accountable.
Hi Namhla, it's such an honor to be speaking to you tonight. Now, why do you think it's so important for brands as powerful as McDonald's to celebrate women in the way that they are tonight?
You know, they've titled today Small Moments of Appreciation. And essentially, I think it's just a moment for South African women to take a breather and to be validated for the amazing value that they bring in society. McDonald's cultural ethos is to recognize emerging leaders. And I think this is a beginning of saying, how do we start recognizing women for their role? But also, how do we start a conversation going with South African women about how McDonald's can become a better and a greater corporate citizen in South Africa.
Nomzamo, you're the MC for this beautiful event tonight, and you're also an ambassador for McDonald's South Africa. What role have female role models played in your own life?
Sure, too many. From my grandmother who raised me and taught me about self-worth and self-love, to the women of Gwamashu who were always so protective of this little girl, to the women that I'm surrounded with in the industry who inspire me every single day, because in each and every corner you look around and you just see everyone just winning and everyone just doing their little bit to just inspire the young generation that's coming behind us, and learning from my biggest role models lessons in life.
So Joanne, you've had a remarkable journey with McDonald's. You've worked your way up from trainee manager to chief operations and supply chain officer. So what do you attribute your success?
I think I attribute my journey to the fact that McDonald's is a brand that embraces the contribution that women can make to building a big brand such as it is today.
It's such a beautiful evening. There's so many exquisite women in the room. What is your hope for women tonight?
So I don't hope anything, because I'm a firm believer that hope is not a strategy. My absolute belief is that firstly, women must define success for themselves and not necessarily be caught up in the stereotypical expectation of society. So for women, I would say define what success looks like for you and allow yourself to reach your full potential.
It's Women's Month. We are 16 days in. What would you say to the wives, the mothers, the daughters, the leaders of industry in South Africa who are women celebrating Women's Month?
We're often at a crossroads in our lives, and we're probably at a crossroads in this country. And at a crossroads, you have choices and you have decisions to make. And for us, or for me, women have decisions and women have choices. Never let anyone take that away. Your choices and your decisions are yours.
From this small moment of great appreciation and meeting of like minds, big things will come. But before that, there was dancing to be done.
Yes, we do love us some strong women.
Absolutely.
Now, moving to the next segment, the South African Police Service is a microcosm of the entire nation. It is one of the few places where people from literally all walks of life are flung together, often under very difficult and dangerous circumstances.
This is exactly what the new SABC 3 drama, The Docket, is about.
Duncan Johnson and Seputla Sebogodi's characters solve crimes and warm relations between the public and the police. Welcome to The Loft. Lovely to have you with us.
So your witness, what did we find?
Enola Williams.
Witcher stays, and she will like it. And that is an order.
No woman's been able to handle what we do.
Because no woman can handle you.
Am I any worse than the evil we chase?
Colonel von Beek, there are people who want this project with the mayor to fail.
Your mistake with the Dockets could have brought down the Ravens.
You said you understood.
Let me make it clear.
Having Mucha join the Ravens is the price we pay for getting the investigation against you dropped.
Von Beek! Von Beek!
Witcher, Umfazi Kagosi was in interview room one. Cesar Van Wyk.
Yes, sir.
As Bonnie has already welcomed you guys to The Loft, but now after watching that, I'm feeling some type of way, ladies. It being Ladies Month and a cast full of women, tell me you guys don't feel that way. What was happening in that scene?
What?
Oh, you guys, now they have nothing to say. Now they've got nothing to say. You guys are dissing women in that scene.
Yes, because they were playing themselves.
No. I was the good guy. For a change.
You were the good guy.
I was playing a good guy. For a change, you know?
For a change, because you're always a baddie.
You know?
But baddies are the best. They get the best lines.
Yeah.
I'm absolutely obsessed with this new series because it's all based on real-life crimes that have been committed. Yes. Like, that is insane. Yeah. So did the researcher go through, like, actual police dockets and then write? And, I mean, how close did you get to these cases?
Well, like, did you get to meet any of the real criminals? Apparently you had to, but you must also understand it is most of those cases have been solved.
Okay.
And although it is based on actual cases, we only used it, or the writers only used it as a springboard. So it's not like a replica. And it is, you must also remember, this is fictional.
Yeah.
The Ravens don't really exist. It's a fictional crime, your high-profile crime unit.
Absolutely. No, of course.
But I must say it was well-written. Eh?
Yeah,
amazing.
Exceptionally well-written, yes.
It's well-directed.
It's so exciting to see Hlubin Boya back on our screens. I really enjoy her work.
Great.
But it looks like a really grueling task. I mean, I have the pleasure of always being typecast as a detective, so I know what it's like to fight crime.
We love you, fast
crime. Calm all the way, but it's hardcore. Detective series are not a joke.
Yes, no, and especially this one, because this is like a South African CI type, and it's very gritty.
Sure.
Yes, and it really packs a punch because it's very close to the bone, and because it's local stuff, like you said, it's crimes that actually happened. So people can identify with it, because the crimes that or some of the episodes that we've gotten, we've covered, are campus rapes, and some of them are still continuing.
Oh, shucks.
Farm murders,
cybercrime,
still continuing, lots of others,
And on set, at times, I mean, I've been friends with Duncan for a long time, and Hlubi. You wouldn't believe, we never had a chance to drink tea and say, hey, how was the soccer? No.
Yes. It's just go.
You'll be looking at how you're going to execute this part.
Of course.
And the directors were so hard on us.
Yeah.
So we had to crack it. And
Hats off to her.
Oh,
yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
And after some of the scenes we had, Hlubi and myself, and we had a go at each other, we had to hug. Sometimes she was in tears. Because she plays from the heart.
It's emotional.
Yeah. Mm. All the actors. Yeah. They brought a lot of passion to the product, and everybody, the creative team, the DOP, the director, everybody, whether the extras, featured extras.
Yeah.
I mean, when it was finished after 3 months, and it's actually 3 months was too short. We were working most of the time until 2 in the morning.
Wow.
There's some stages where we worked. I don't know if you were part of that scene where we were like 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yes.
And you slept in a tent.
That's just one. That's one thing because I
left my car and took an Uber to from Joburg to Pretoria because I couldn't drive after that.
Wow.
I couldn't drive.
Sounding like the true professionals you are, but I'm so interested as to who each of these characters are that we see portrayed so effortlessly on screen.
But.
My character, as you could see there, is a bit of a chauvinist, and in the police force, male-dominated force, he doesn't want women there because he believes it is a very dark and dangerous environment to be in. And what you don't really see, or what he doesn't tell them, is he is a bit protective over them because he knows what can happen. He is a profiler, and the cases that they do are all high-profile cases, and it's very dangerous. They deal with serial killers, which is also based, again, on true crimes that happened in South Africa.
Crazy. Yeah. So this is basically CSI South Africa.
There you go.
But that means you've got to start casting us to play in the
role. You can cast her as the criminal. Please cast her. But you know what I love about a South African detective series? If you think about it, if you ask yourself, what is just a public opinion? Who do people think are the best cops in the world? American cops, right? Yes. Because they make so many detective series, and the public then believe that they know how to fight crime, that they know how to protect and serve, and that they're the best cops in the world. And I just love that we're seeing so many detective series in South Africa, so that we can start believing that our cops are actually
about this product.
Yeah.
You see the quality, the people involved, like I said, and the main ingredient there was passion. The actors and everybody involved.
And it was well written, eh?
Yeah.
Well written. It was
beautiful.
Magnifico.
Did you get to go and hang out with any real cops and go and do like night, you know, when they go and do what's the thing?
Time restrictions. This is not we have to understand, this is not big budget America. Where you can have 2 weeks or even a month or 2 months with the same people for training and actually pay you to go and do those things, and you go to the shooting range and all those things and combat and lessons.
Like learn how to hold the gun properly.
Yes, you are. Yeah, listen, we are shooting this time restraints budget. Come, we have to
do
this.
But you know what, Duncan? One day is one day.
Exactly.
One day is one day.
And also, you must understand.
But we must have the budget too.
There you go.
One day is one day.
Also, we are freelance actors, so we've got other jobs as well. Yeah. So we have to fit everything in, and the schedule is very tight. And talking about sleeping in the tent, yes, I'm guilty. I was the one sleeping in the tent because for 3 months I had average, I'm not kidding, 3 hours sleep a night. Because you shoot until, like I said, 2 a.m. and at one stage we were shooting at 3 a.m. In short sleeve, freezing weather on a private airstrip with mercenaries and stuff like that. But it's par for the course, and the passion is there, and we're all professional actors.
Yeah.
And we're fortunate to get the directors that we got.
Brilliant.
Dom, for me, is one of the best directors in the world, not
who
in
directed?
South Africa.
Young and created Dom.
Dom.
Oh, wow.
And Clive also helped. Clive Morris also helped. Yeah. And, of course, the DOP.
Yeah. Mr. Black. How can we forget
just call
Mr.
him Mr. Black? Yeah. Daniel Black, And the shots that you're going to see.
Oh, amazing.
They are so creative. You will see some of the shots.
I can't wait.
You won't believe how they got it, how they got the shot right. One shot through the entire house, handheld.
Yeah.
I don't know. So your mind will boggle.
And Seputla, don't think you're off the hook. You tried to pass the buck onto your friend here.
Yeah.
We want to find out about your character too. And also, are there any scenes that you were like really gruesomed out by in your character?
Well, for the first time in my life, especially in South Africa, I don't know. I'm always, you know, cast as a crook, you know, and I'm killing people. For the first time, I played a good guy. He was not even a corrupt cop, you know. He was
the good cop.
The good cop.
Yeah, and for me, it was a nice change, and I love playing the character.
Yeah,
that's beautiful. There was not like nothing heavy.
So there were no, like in CSI, you see the blood and the guts and the bone.
None of
that?
You guys did all your own stunts, right? So you had to be fit, you had to be on it.
Can you drop, roll, and get up and shoot?
Yeah.
No, the character.
Keep watching.
Like you mean Kaneskowski and Donner.
Thank you so much for being here. We cannot wait to watch the show. I think it's going to be amazing.
Yeah.
It's going to be the biggest hit on SABC.
We hope so.
Is yours.
The stage is definitely yours. Now, after the break, we are treated to a performance from our national treasure, Steve Kekana, after this.
Our guests on Afternoon Express fly domestically with Mango. Enjoy outstanding service, online check-in and seat selection. With the widest booking and payment options, Mango is the only airline globally to accept store charge cards as a means of payment. Fly in comfort with ergonomically efficient seats for more legroom aboard a fleet of new generation Boeing 737-800 aircraft. Join the guests of Afternoon Express and fly Mango.
Welcome back from the ad break. You're tuned in to Afternoon Express on SABC3, where the stage is yours. Now, finally, the moments we've all been waiting for. Performing his song titled Unomalizo live in the loft is Steve Kekana, ladies and gentlemen. Take it away.
Musukala
Ikhulekela wena yo sthandwa sa Ikhulekela wena ye sthandwa sa Ikhulekela wena sthandwa sa
So
absolutely.
Yeah.
Wow, well done. Thank you so much.
Congrats. So I just want to ask the two of you, I mean, it seems like the world, TV is the new big screen, once again. And then we're going to obviously see the digitization of that. But what are you excited about when it comes to South African series and just in general?
Well, if I can just say, talking about the Docket, all the effort that went into it, the quality that went into it, and like I keep on saying passion, because it was a passion project.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they got such a lot done with so little. And although it is high quality and it is homegrown, proudly South African, it definitely has, and I'm not kidding you, universal appeal.
Yeah. Beautiful. Amazing. We're so excited to watch. Thank Congratulations on that amazing performance. Now, when is your new album coming out?
The album will be released on the 16th of September. This is my original birthday. Yeah. And I'm saying original because in my ID they say I was born on the 4th of August. Actually, I was born before I was born. But the real birthday is 16th of September. And that is the day when this album will be released.
Gorgeous. Wow, that was a beautiful song. It felt like a lullaby, actually. Mm.
Mm. Very soothing.
Yeah, yeah.
And touching. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Finally, we have another exclusive. Thank you for bringing it to us.
Thank you so much. So join us again on Monday as we chat to Cape Town Women's Network, whose aim is to recognize and celebrate the work of the game changers in their respective industries. Plus, we have the internationally acclaimed band Freshly Ground performing live. It's about time.
I love them. Yeah. I'm so excited.
Yes.
Thank you so much to all of our guests for being here today. It's been absolutely an absolute treasure. And to you at home. Lovely seeing you. We'll be back again tomorrow. Good night and God bless.
Good night and God bless.
Afternoon Express, made with love by Clover.
Another feel-good production.